afternoon, everyone. It is my pleasure to reach you this afternoon through God's Word. And I want to make this clear to you that I'm here to bless you or to encourage you in accordance with God's Word. To start with, I want you to understand that God has a purpose for your life. He cares for you. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows your name. He knows where you live. He knows exactly what you've been experiencing for the past days, the past month, maybe in your family, with your health, maybe at your places of work, or maybe personally. But I want to encourage you tonight for you to understand that God is waiting. I mean, God Almighty, Jehovah, is waiting. He's the owner of your life, the creator of the heavens and the earth. Is waiting on you, and he wants to bless you. He wants to see you through. Let us pray together. Our Father and our God, we thank you for this blessed moment. We give you praise. Thank you because of what we're about to do. Father, we just exalt your name. We ask that your word will bless the heart and the lives of your people. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I'm going to be reading from Isaiah chapter number 1 from verse 18 and verse 19. You may have read the scripture before, or you may have you may have heard someone minister through this few verses before, but I'm going to just use it to be a blessing to you by God's special grace. In verse 18 of Isaiah chapter 1, it says, "Come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient," it says, "ye shall eat the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel," says, "ye shall be devoured with the sword. For the mouth of the Lord had spoken it." The mouth of the Lord had spoken it. One thing that caught my attention in these verses, in verse 18 and 19, is the word "come." When God, through his servant, the prophet Isaiah, speaking to his people, he was saying to them, "Come and let us reason together." In other words, God is a relational God. God is a God of fellowship. He loves to fellowship. He's a father. He's our father. He is your father. In fact, the Bible says that one of the main and the most important reason why mankind, human beings, were created is for fellowship. The Bible says that God created us out of his own image and likeness. In other words, you do not resemble anyone else but God. You do not look like anyone else but God. The reason is that God will fellowship with you. Were there other beings upon the face of the earth? Of course, yes, there were animals. Were there other creatures in the heavens or the heavenlies? Yes, of course. But then the Bible says you are uniquely created in his image. According to Psalm 8, the scripture clearly says, "For we are fearfully and wonderfully made." Why? We are the image of God, and we are creatures of worship, fellowship. But after man sinned against God, the Bible says we lost our dominion. We lost our status. We lost that relationship with God. Then eventually the Bible says sin separated us from God. Sin separated us from God's will. Sin separated us from God's plan and purpose. But then in John chapter 3 verse 16, the Bible says, "For God so loved the world." I believe it is the most common scriptures in Christendom today. It says, "God so loved the world that he created an opportunity for us wherein he sent Jesus." He said he gave his only son, that whosoever can be you, no matter your race, your creed, your tribe, your nationality, your background, whosoever can be you, that if only you believe, it doesn't cost you a dime. You don't have to pay because he had already paid. You don't have to sacrifice anything because he is the sacrifice himself. He said that if only you believe, you will not perish, but you will have everlasting life. And so Isaiah was saying the same thing also in Isaiah chapter 1 verse 18. He says, "Come." One thing that I want to make known to you today, if someone calls you, or if you are calling me, or if I am calling you to come over, or you are calling me to come over on your side, the very first thing you should understand is that there is an opportunity for you to make a move. You have to make a move. You make a move towards God. Many a times, a lot of people have been saying they're waiting for God, unknowingly that even after their birth, God has been waiting for them. Hallelujah. It was David who said, "In sin did my mother conceive me." He knew that you were a sinner at birth.
you know, and you begin to die since the day you were born. But yet, with an open hand, as a father, he's been calling on us to come. So you have to make a move. That's number one. Number two, not only that you have to make a move, but that you should also understand that the reason why God is calling you to come is that because he has a plan for your life. He wants to enable you, to empower you, so that you'll be able to maximize your potentials as his image, so that you'll be able to achieve your goal as his image, so that you'll be able to live a life of dominion. Remember when God created man in his image and likeness in Genesis 1? The Bible says God created the heavens and earth, but there was no controller, there was no governor, there was no one in control. But the Bible says after he created man in his image and likeness in chapter 2 verse 26 downwards, if you read, the Bible says he gave man dominion. So that dominion that we've lost is what God is trying to restore again. He's trying to bring us back to that position of authority and control. So the Bible says that he's calling us so that we can become useful, so that we can make a move and get in to where he is. And not only that, for us to also be able to become what we should. Hallelujah. He has something in store for you. And if God called you to come, in other words, he's saying you should refrain. Refrain from what you are to what you should become. Hallelujah. Refrain from where you are to where you ought to be. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But then let's talk about something very major. Let us, you and God, we and God, we do what? We're going to reason together. That is God's plan. This baffles my mind. It shocks me when I read the scripture that God, he is Almighty God, and he's calling his subject to what? To reasoning together. You know, I discovered that all others that are professing, being religious or being God or whatever it may be, I discovered one thing, that they were all created by God Almighty himself. I'm talking about Jehovah God. I'm talking about Yahweh. Even Satan himself, breaking news, my dear, even Satan himself knew his creator. He knows very well that God is his owner. He knows very well that God is his creator. So when God says, come and let us reason together, it is a very unique opportunity for the creator to call his subject to a point of reasoning or negotiation. Hallelujah. Most idols don't do that. Most demons don't even. In fact, they feel threatening of their position. Satan will never do that. If I let me announce this to you, one of the agenda of the enemy is that he will never make you his friend. He will never make you his sons and daughters. He will never make you part of his family. In fact, he wants you to be his subject and his subject forever. Hallelujah. Because remember, his intention initially was that he wanted to be God, to rule and to reign. But thank God for the God whom we serve. The Bible says he called us. The Bible says in St. John chapter 1 verse 12, it says, for as many as have received him, to them he gave you power to become sons and daughters of God. Imagine God making you or restoring your sonship back and restoring that position, that status. I have an announcement to you today. And the thing that I want to make known to you today is that you are next in line, because you are God next of King. Hallelujah. You are God next of King. So the Bible says, let us reason. Why are we going to reason? Why should we reason with the Lord? Hallelujah. When he is God Almighty, he is divinity, and we are humanity. You know, it is funny today when men, psychologists, philosophers, they tend to accredit humanity to divinity, forgetting the fact that there is no way that you will ever become God. We will never ever become God. The only thing is that we are God's children. We are God's creatures. We are God's image. We are God's children. Hallelujah. So he's calling us to reasoning together. He says, come and let us reason together. Let us negotiate. Hallelujah. Can I ask you a question? My question to you is this. If you fail to reason with God now, how would you escape? In fact, the scripture says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Now pay attention to this. God is not calling you to reasoning because He wanted you to serve him. No, 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 no. Even if you choose not to serve him, there are quadrillions of angels that are in heaven that are ready to serve God. Even if you refuse to serve God, there are others out there who are ready and willing. So God is not calling you to worship. He's not calling you to service. He's not calling you to relationship because he wants to maintain his status. No, no, no. With or without you, he is independently God. Hallelujah. You want me to say that again? With or without you, God Almighty, I mean Yahweh, Adonai, El Shaddai, Jehovah himself, the Bible says he is independently God. Hallelujah. So God can even do without you. Amen. God, I repeat it again, God can do without you. Calls you to this opportunity. You have the privilege to come by and listening together with him is as a result of his love towards you. Amen. It's because he cares for you. But if you refuse or you fail to reason with God, ask yourself this question: what would I achieve? Ask yourself this question: what is it that at the end of this life, in fact the Bible says, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Why would you risk your eternal life? Amen. Why would you allow yourself, because of one snatching pleasure, to overwhelm and overtake and destroy and shatter your destiny? Why would you allow the pleasures of this life to overwhelm you? Why would you allow others, people around you, friends, money, pleasures, or whatever it is, to move you away from God's plan and God's will? I want to announce to you today that God is not against you. God is for you and God loves you. He cares for you. But trust me, if you miss this chance, you miss this opportunity here on earth, if you die in your sin, I repeat, if you die in your sin, the Bible says it is a fearful thing for a man to fall into the hands of God. If I fall into the hands of a government, I will be rescued. If I fall into the hands of a police, I will be rescued. If I fall into the hands of armed robbers, I will be rescued. If you fall into the hands of even demons, God can even rescue you. But woe betide you, you fall into the hands of God. Who is that rescuer? Who is that lawyer? Who is that doctor? Who is that deliverer that will show up to deliver you from the hands of Jehovah God? You have a chance today. God is saying, let us reason. I know you've been sinning against me. I know you've done a whole lot of things against me, but let us reason. Can I say this to you? Maybe you are listening to this message to the TV media or whatever, or online or whatever it may be, and you have some issues against God because of what you've been going through. Or maybe because of the trials, the challenges, and the difficulties of your life, you are bitter against God and against church and against God's people. Or maybe because of one disappointment or the other, or one negative experience with a Christian or a believer or a church or a pastor, and you are bitter, you are angry, and you say, I'm not going to church anymore, I'm not going to fellowship anymore. No, 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 no. I want to announce to you today that God is innocent. God loves you. He cares for you. Amen. He knows you by name and by nature. He's not against you today, but he's saying, come and let us reason together. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says, let's continue. He says, save the Lord. He says, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Wow. What a privilege. What an opportunity. It's an open check. Hallelujah. He says, though your sins, all that you have done. What are your sins? It may be abortion. It may be fornication. It may be adultery. It may be lying. It may be jealousy. It may be unforgiveness. It may be bitterness. It may be witchcraft. It may be occultic practices. It may be idolatry. Whatever your sins are today, I want to announce to you today, if you are willing, you are ready, you are made up your mind to say, God, I repent of my sins, God will not throw you away, but God will accommodate you. I repeat myself. He will not throw you away. He will not reject you. He will accommodate you. Hallelujah. There is an open hands waiting for you to welcome you. In fact, even the angels that are in heaven, they are waiting for this day. They are waiting for a chance like this, a moment like this, wherein you will say, Lord, I am sorry for all my sins. The scripture says, do your sin. What is sin? Sin is worse than cancer. Sin is worse than cancer. Cancer can kill a man but won't take you to hell. But sin will take you to hell. In fact, let me break this to you, that sin is even worse than hell. I repeat myself, sin is even worse than hell, because hell has nothing to do with you. Hell cannot grab you to force you into its place. But I want to announce to you that sin can drag you into hell. Not only that, take note of this. That Satan is smart enough. He might not paint sin for you to understand that sin is terrible. Sin is dangerous. Sin is bad. He won't say that. But it will bring a whole lot of pleasure and wrap it up. So when you see sin, when you look at the life of sin, or when you get into the pleasures of sin, you will totally forget that the consequences are waiting. And you know the worst thing is that the consequences that comes after sin is even worse than the sin itself. I repeat again, the consequences that comes after sin is even worse than the sin itself. Because you know what? Sin will take you, it will take you through so much trauma. And the worst thing is that sin will also take you through a journey that you never bargained for. It will take you farther than you anticipated. Hallelujah. Sin will torture you. If you do not deal with that sin today, that sin might eventually deal with you. If you do not deal with that sin today, that sin might eventually deal with you. Another breaking news is this, that even Satan himself is a victim of sin. I repeat myself, even Satan himself is a victim of sin. So if Satan is trying to deceive you because of sin, it's as a result of him being a victim already. But I want to announce to you today, the good news is, he said, though your sins be as red as crimson, they'll be as white as snow, they'll be as scarlet. Hallelujah. Satan will never accommodate you to be his friend. He will never. Amen. I want to say this to you, that there are men of God in the Bible who once, in fact, they served the Lord, but they made some terrible choices in life, and they hurt themselves because of sin. No wonder you see sometimes even in the news, when you hear about what a government minister has done, or maybe what the president has been doing, or maybe what a lawyer is doing, or maybe even the church, what is happening to the church, or to the members, or to the pastor, or whatever the case might be, sometimes it becomes a reproach, sometimes it becomes a laughingstock, sometimes it becomes a problem, because the end of sin is disgrace. The end of sin, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Not only that, the end of sin brings you reproach and trauma. I'll give you an example of Solomon. Solomon was, the Bible says, he was the wisest man ever lived upon the face of the earth. He can deal with every aspect of issue and every aspect and issues of life. He can deal with administration. He can deal with issues that has to do with science. When he talks about astrology, he knows it. When he talks about philosophy, he knows it. When he talks about humility, he knows it. When he talks about humanity, he knows it. When you everything you talk about, Solomon has knowledge. I mean extraordinary knowledge. Divine knowledge that was impacted in his life by the hand of Almighty God. But you know what? Solomon failed when it comes to sin. He could handle every aspect of his life, but he could not handle his sin. And eventually, you know what happened. You know the story, that Solomon failed woefully. David was another example. He was a king, a man in his own domain, anointed by God. In fact, the Bible referred to David as a man after God's own heart. A worshiper that could touch the heart of God and touch the throne of God. But one day, David saw a woman taking shower somewhere. While he was up in his palace and he looked down and lo and behold, he picked up Uriah's wife. A king that could handle a kingdom could not handle his sin. A king that could handle Goliath, he can slay Goliath, but he cannot slay the sin within himself. No wonder the scripture says it was God himself who took upon himself to call on us to reason with him. He can deal with sin. You cannot save yourself from your sins. No wonder you struggle and struggle and struggle and tried and tried and tried. The more you try, the more you fail, because there is no medication for sin. There's one medication, there's one answer, there's one solution. Not your religion, not that worship that you are doing in that particular religion, assuming that God will reward you as a result or take away your sin. No. It was John the Baptist that saw Jesus one day. And he says, behold the Lamb of God. Ha-ya-ya. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. I wish I have more time, a few more minutes, I would have emphasized on that word. Behold the Lamb of God. It taketh away the sin of the world. I want to announce to you today that the Lord will take away your sin. The Lord will take away your sin because God is not against you. Hallelujah. He loves you. He cares for you. And God wants to give you another chance. I mean another chance, another opportunity to make a change in your life. He says, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. I want to announce to you that the bulls and the goats and the doves and all the sacrifices and the incense that you're offering and you're sacrificing won't save you. They won't take away your sins. The religious rituals that you are practicing won't take away your sins. There's one way out of your sin, and that is the Lamb of God. And the Lamb of God is Jesus. He was born in a stable. He was born in the place where all the lambs were to be born. And he is the only one that will take away your sins. If you're willing and you're ready today, I want to announce to you that Jesus will save you from your sins. If only you will say, Lord, I agree. In fact, the scripture says, it says, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be as crimson, it said, they shall be as wool. Verse 19, it says, if ye be willing and obedient. One condition. Just one. Not even two. Just one. Remember the problem in the Garden of Eden. It was one sin of disobedience that causes the entire human race to fall into sin. One sin of disobedience destroyed everything that God had already endowed in mankind. Man was powerful. Man was in control. We dominate the universe. But sin brought us down to nonsense. The Bible says, if you are willing, are you willing tonight? Are you willing this morning? Are you willing this afternoon? Or whatever time you may catch up with us, as you're watching this telecast, are you willing today? The Bible says if you're willing and you're obedient, it says you will eat the good of the land. There is good in the land. Hallelujah. There is good right here in Canada. There is good in the land. There is good in the city of Toronto. Maybe you've been struggling to make ends meet in your life. You've been struggling to walk through life in your own way. You've been struggling to make your business work. You've been trying all your best to make your family and everything work. It doesn't seem to work for you. Why? Because you're not yet willing. If you're willing to surrender unto God, you're willing to say, Lord, have mercy. Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, I'm wrong. Lord, forgive me. God will forgive you. He's willing today and he's ready to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. If you're ready and you're willing, just bow your head with me as we pray. Let us pray together. Say this with me. Say, dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I repent today of my sins. Forgive me for all that I have done. I have sinned against you and against your word. Forgive me, Lord. Remove my name from the book of death that is in hell. Write my name in the book of life with the blood of Jesus. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that God raised you from the dead. Jesus, be my Lord and Savior. Amen.